You know, give it the push towards the e-governance and the democracy stuff. Now, this is ends up being highly related to open data. Who knows what open data is about? Don't worry, I'm not gonna grade you or something. So, your name?
Lorenzo.
Lorenzo, nice to meet you, Lorenzo. Tell me. So, have you heard some?
I think I'm not really sure, but I think...
Perfect, I'm not sure either, so...
Okay, it's the data that the government gives to everyone, and they can elaborate the data and make whatever they want with the data.
Okay, public. Actually, it's public. It's public data. Okay, there is quite a strict definition regarding open data. Mostly has to do with the availability. So it's not necessarily, essentially, only government data. Even though in most cases, this is what you expect. So the idea is that you have lots of data lying around. Imagine that there are maps of the streets for a given country. Okay, but no one has access to these maps. So if they were put in a machine-readable way somewhere, you might be able to use a GPS and have it paint out the way to go from here to Barcelona, I don't know, something. Okay, so this information about the layout of the road network, can be very important. Okay, and essentially, these data were not available until recently. You had to pick a van, have it go around, and somehow send back the data to a receiver and slowly draw the map. However, as I have already said, this data existed somewhere, because people, especially in the government, used the data to do several stuff. Okay. Now there are data also about meteorological, sent from sensors of meteorology, temperature, wind speed, and so forth. Imagine that each ship has its own data about its fuel consumption. Okay, now let's try to combine these things. If you know the wind strength in the sea over time, if you know the distance between two points in the globe, and if you know the fuel consumption, you might try to optimize how ships go around the globe to minimize the fuel they need. Okay, so you can try to build on these things using math and optimization methods, for example, to try to find the best route to a specific place to, as I said, optimize the fuel consumption. You can do things like, I will create my own weather model based on the temperatures in Athens the last 15 years, because I can do it better than others, but I can try to. Okay, so the Open Data Initiative says that we provide data to the public, paying attention also to security issues. So having every move I make based on my mobile phone positioning information is not the best thing to do. Okay, I would not like this to be open data. So there are several questions, but open data is about reusing existing data. Okay, so why am I here? Except for providing, of course, cookies and coffee and everything else. I'm going to talk in this section about semantic technologies on open data, natural language technologies on open data, and also some use cases from here from Democritus. It is related to open consultation, policy making. Does anyone know what open consultation is? Sorry, let me put it the other way around. Who of you don't know what open consultation is? Perfect, nice? Okay, perfect. I've noted down your names. So, open consultation is when politicians and governments ask the people to express their opinion on laws. Nice. And one would expect this thing to function as feedback mechanism to alter the law and modify it so that it's the best law possible. Okay. Ideal. Okay, so there is open consultation in Greece. Actually, it's extremely active. And we've seen that when searching for similar open consultation efforts in the rest of the EU, for example, you can find several countries who have not developed such a need, rather such a set of tools for open consultation. The thing is that here in Greece, everyone wants to put their hand on the law and change it. But because we have an amazingly bad, amazingly difficult to follow set of laws that keep changing and I don't know, it's some kind of a mutation thing over time, and it's very difficult to follow. So people, and new laws are created every day, which is bad, okay, for several things. And we never follow them, so why do it? But what I'm trying to say is that at some point there is so much difficulty in knowing the law that it's very difficult to be law-abiding. So open consultation tries to act a priori before the law comes out and ask for opinions, okay? Policy making is the process where...
Can they change the law after the open consultation?
Yes, they have done it. So there was a law that said it was a law, the first example which was successful of open consultation was a law concerning the cars our politicians use. Okay, so they asked, okay, people tell us your opinion because we have created these specifications for the cars, and the sellers of cars said, hey guys, the specifications you gave limit the whole range of possible cars to a single one. Yes. Okay, but really the people did not know, and they altered the thing and said, come on. Okay, they hadn't checked the thing out. So the sellers provided more information and they broadened the specifications to allow for other types of cars because otherwise it was sold out somehow. So they do use it. There is a minor comment here. There is also always a way, actually every law has to pass through the process of open consultation, except for urgent ones. So nice, I do not want this to pass through open consultation. It's urgent, okay, and they're done. But anyway, this is not the base case, okay? You can have all kinds of actions trying to move around open consultation, but it exists as a tool. You can, it will sound Greek to you, but anyway, you can check it on opengov.gr. There is a site that does exactly this thing, okay? We'll see more about this later. It will be the focus of the presentation. So, policy making is the process of creating policies, of getting new laws, of reacting to existing designing things and scheduling how you will move forward. Okay, so policy making is another domain where all these technologies make sense. And there is also open semantic data exploitation, how you will exploit the data out there. And you will see something. We will talk about nuclear emergency crisis management. We do that in Democritus. Mm-hmm. We will save you at the possible nuclear threat, but we'll talk about this later. So, why go semantic? As I said, semantic in terms of technology means that you try to express something in a way that machines understand it. Okay, that's mostly what semantics is about. If I had a linguist here, he or she would throw tomatoes at me or something at the least. Beer bottles, I don't know, something. Because they have, this term is used all around, it had become a hype for, I don't know, last four years, and it goes on. You have heard of the semantic web, for example, perhaps. So there is lots of machine-readable knowledge, and when you talk about semantic information, you create very simple statements and feed them to computer. Something like, George works in Democritus. Okay, so this is a very simple statement. There are 15.4 billion such statements now on a very single project that's called Linked Open Data Cloud. These statements allow the computer to do reasoning. So people in Democritus are extremely prone to talking a lot. Nice. So George works at Democritus. Given the previous statement, George has a tendency to speak a lot, which is useful now because I'm the only one speaking. So This allows reasoning, as I said. This is why a machine will do things that previously it would not be able to do without this kind of knowledge. This billion of triples is now called big data. You will hear about this all around if you move on to research and to EU funding projects, because people like big data. There's lots of data out there, they don't know what to do with it. When you have semantic information, you can apply reasoning, as I said. So you can ask questions and about whether George speaks a lot that you would not be able to answer previously without reasoning, without doing this kind of easy process we humans do. And there is also, you can integrate sources, as I said before, from several domains using semantic information and answer complex queries. And the nice thing about it is that machines do the dirty job. You do not have to gather all the evidence you need to do things. And also the semantic web is partially here. The semantic web is all about, imagine that everything you write in your blog is communicated in a machine-readable way. That's the idea. So people will be able to ask very complex questions that will combine all the knowledge expressed by people on the web. And the computer will be able to answer it. There are scenarios anyway, that you can ask something like, hey, my personal assistant, which is a computer, please find me the quickest, the cheapest tickets out of Greece or into Greece for a period where the sun is supposed to be shining. And you have an agent going out there searching for patterns in the meteorological data and the sea level, I don't know, the temperature and the level of drinks in the people's glasses for a given time in the year, and also try to find a cheap airline and negotiate and so forth. This would not be possible without a semantic web. Okay. All these things are research domains related to the semantic aspect of data exploitation, data use, data gathering, data representation, querying, stuff. So there are lots of ways to represent statements for a computer to understand. That's one thing. The second is, you can ask the computer in many different languages. Unfortunately, none of them is human. Okay. They are somewhat mathematically driven. There is lots of work on how to store and index things. Okay, we have billions of blogs. How can we efficiently search all these blogs in real time, for example? If you ask a query in Google and it takes 3 seconds or 5 seconds to answer, it's too much. If you have gotten used to 0.3. Okay. There are research on distributed platforms on how to ask many different systems. As I said before, the data from the temperature of Athens is in a completely different institution. You can find it in a completely different website than you can find the airline tickets interfaces. So you want to be able to ask, as I said, heterogeneous systems, systems that are not created in one single way. And you can have also, there is also this web of things. You have sensors all around sensing different sensible things. Nice. So temperature, as I said, the position of your car or your mobile phone position, the last time you opened your door and so forth. Okay, the calls you had, these all can be considered sensing devices, the temperature of your refrigerator. Some of these can be streams. Okay, the temperature of your refrigerator is not one single value, it's a value over time. And especially in industrial applications, for example, in wind power generators, you can have something like 150,000 measurements per second. 150 kilohertz. Okay, these are sensors that try to monitor how quickly the wind generator rotates, for example. So in order to be able to combine these things, you also want to be able to ask complex questions on these streams, on the data that have such big throughput that it's difficult to manage. And lots more. So why use language technologies? Again, machines will do the dirty job. This is nice for humans. I'm not sure for machines, but thank God Matrix is not here already, so we're fine. Not yet, right? I'm sure you will do your best. So the idea is that we want to exploit free text so people do not write in machine readable ways. We express ourselves freely. And this is nice. But a machine cannot exploit this kind of information. Okay, it cannot reason upon that. So the idea is that we want to exploit free text automatically, generate knowledge out of that, and also provide user-friendly ways to interact with this information. Again, these are domains of research of natural language technologies that make sense to cover this, to answer these questions, okay, to achieve what we asked for before. Information extraction is when you get, imagine that you have a text and you want to ask who does it talk about. Okay, then you have the information extraction there and it determines named entities, for example, people's names, or the place it refers to. Imagine that this can directly help the next domain, information retrieval. Bring me the things that talk about Athens, but the Athens in Greece and not in the US. Okay, this would be the information retrieval section. There's also text mining, as I said. Find out interesting trends related to movies. About what movie do people talk about? Okay, this is text mining. Similarly, text analytics. Text analytics is a term that says, please quantify some things that are said in texts, because I don't want to need to read 1,000 texts to determine who is the most popular actor. Okay, so it can analyze thousands or billions of texts, the machine, and bring back some quantitative information. Cheers.
Yamas.
Okay, so there's also argumentation mining, especially for open consultation, and also as the focus of this workshop is supposed to be e-governance and e-democracy. Argumentation mining is trying to determine the arguments people pose as relates to laws. Okay, so if they say the law sucks, it's fine, but it's not an argument. If it says the law sucks because the cars, you have the range of the cars is actually a single car, it makes sense. So you want to be able somehow to extract these arguments and gather them in a way that the politician will be able to use them for good or for bad. Also, there is summarization. Imagine a world where you can ask a summary of what I said today, and you did not need to come here. That would be nice, and I would also lose my job, but it's fine. So I work on that. Okay, so the idea is that you try to gather from several sources information and provide them in a single summary. It's also excellent for tasks at home, for homework, this thing, and for projects. And there's also natural language generation. You want the machine to be able to respond, even in written, in a humanly readable way, and in a nice way. So you can ask it to present things as you would understand them, and not with some kind of statement, dot statement, or machine readable stuff. This is natural language generation. It's when you ask the computer to speak in a human way. And of course, you can apply all this on social media. Especially for those of you who work on software, you may have seen or sensed that social media is an extremely big bang that came around about, I don't know, 5 years ago. We do not know the end of it. This phenomenon is constantly altering, changing, and updating itself. But the idea is that you need to be able to extract information from there. There are lots of companies who try to exploit information from social media to find where you live, what exactly you do in your house, and also how to provide the best possible ads there. But of course, there are also better applications, like determining whether there is a person who is suicidal from what they are writing in their blogs. And this has been, in Greece especially, it has been detected several times. There are cases where you can detect fraud and of course, stop it or move on. And the idea is that all these things can come by applying these technologies on social media and other things. Okay, so this is example good to you, but there is the OpenGov site, as I said, it's open consultation, free text data, people express themselves freely. It's very useful. It's needed, required actually for lawmaking processes. So our parliament needs a report on what people said for a law, for the law to pass, but it's difficult to manage. Again, as I said, I will stay minimal here. The idea is that we have created in the Mockito site where, let me see if I can do this. Oh, nice. Here, you have a graph that says, it shows how much people...
Sorry, but that doesn't work out. I can't see you. Like, I can't see the slide.
I know. You're like, no? Okay,
no.
So
yes,
I'm
going to
do it. I'm tired. Okay, nice. So here you can see. So this is a graph showing the number, thanks, the number of... so the number of comments people put per article, per law article. For some reason, it might seem that it makes sense to check this out. Okay. And this happens a lot. There are cases where you have comments all over the place, but you want to be able to quantify and see this information in a glimpse. People in OpenGov cannot do this. So we simply applied some statistics here. It's trivial, this thing. Then you can search things. You can try to search about specific topics and so forth. There are also implied topics. So, people talk in free language and they do not state their topic explicitly. Now I'm going to talk about some... No, they don't do that. In your blog, you start describing how you feel or what you think about things. You do not start by saying, I am going to talk about world politics. It's the same thing here. However, from your text, one can determine the topic you're touching at that point. Okay, so the idea is that we are trying to have the computer determine which topic you're touching through your text, what you're talking about. Again, this is done probabilistically through clustering anyway, and you can extract some topics that are over there, and they are indeed all Greek. And we can also provide sentiment analysis where you show whether the person speaks positively, negatively, or neutrally for a specific topic. For some reason, almost, I think, 2 out of 3 comments are negative, if I remember correctly. There are a few positives and even less neutral. Okay, you can check it also out, but if you are not Greek, this will not be very effective. So, moving on from OpenGov, we will revisit later. There's also a European project. What it tries to do is monitor what people are saying, you can see it there, promote and share this data to allow policy making in a way, also gather feedback from people on lawmaking and policy making. This can also apply to companies, okay? Policy is about how also I act towards the community, for example. And it builds on all these things to provide collaboration potential. So this NOMAD, the title is Policy Formulation and Validation Through Non-Moderated Crowdsourcing. Crowdsourcing, have you heard of the term crowdsourcing? Nice. Now I can try to be clever. So crowdsourcing is the thing where you have people do your work. Nice. Okay. Sometimes this is called doing politics, but anyway. So crowdsourcing is about distributing a difficult, big set of tasks so that you have 10,000 people performing one single task, but the result is yours, the combined result is yours to exploit. So if you have people speak about your law, you do not need to have 5,000 meetings with them directly, if you can visit their blog and extract information from there. You might get different information also if you directly access them. So this is the crowdsourcing part. Okay, you split your work. The non-moderated crowdsourcing means, as I said, that you do not force them to do anything. You let them express themselves and you learn from what they have already talked about. And through this, you can try to see how you will form your policy and validate its use. The data in this project are blogs, social networks and media, news, and consultations, open consultations. The role of the project is that you can bring lots of data, reduce its volume, extract its useful part, organize it, and show it to a person so that he can act upon it. Okay, after the end of this the whole workshop today, I will send out, you will see the link, an evaluation form. You will evaluate me, not vice versa. Okay, so the thing is that there, if you will 5,000 people, it will be very difficult to, as I said, to extract the information if I did a one by one check of what you said. So the idea is, again, with Polish formulation is that you do this automatically, but and also from texts, free texts. Okay, that's the idea of Nobel. There is also, I will go rather quickly over this, another point of open governance is learning is acting upon data that are not only from people. So as I said, there exist sensors and several other things that produce data. And there's this Semaglo project we have again in Demokritos. The idea is that you can ask questions as a user and complex questions, as I said before, bring me the set of Greek cities that have a high average temperature, the month we're talking about, for example. And they are next to the sea, because I want to study there. Okay, so these questions cannot be answered at this exact point. If you try to Google this question, you will get lots of irrelevant results. Here the idea is that you try to answer responsively within 10 seconds to such complex questions. Combine information from all around. This is the Semaglo project. And there are lots of challenges there, because you have a variety of data sources, lots of machine readable data, RDF, resource description framework. I will not go deep into that. You can ask me whatever you want. The Semaglo project focuses on agriculture data. Okay, so you have market cultivation, disease, weather conditions, so forth. And it builds upon distributed and heterogeneous sources. So what we do in this project is that we store, and we need to store efficiently, as I said before, several things. We want to be able to talk the language of each separate data provider, which is the ontology alignment and evolution. And we want to be able to, if the user asks one single question, to combine all the information we have, ask queries to 5,000 different sources, and aggregate the results. Okay. And we want to do this on billions of data instances, whatever it is. Do you know what, sorry, has anyone heard about ontologies? Okay.
I heard about it.
Perfect. I know, 5 seconds ago, but I'm talking about it. Okay. That's nice. The others didn't. So I'm going to talk about ontologies now. Okay, so ontologies, the very brief and difficult to understand definition is a conceptualization, the representation of a conceptualization. So in plain English words, it's when you try, when you represent your knowledge of a domain, informatics, in a structured way, expressing the basic concepts and their relations. And this, there is a formal way to do this, so that a machine can understand the thing. There is also a domain in philosophy called ontology, which talks about being. But this is the ontology in informatics and information technologies is a completely different thing. That's a side comment for people who are very interested in hardware. This, including streams there, application on big data including streams, there are serious challenges on how you will store trillions of measurements in existing, on existing disks, for example, hard disks. So there are lots of efforts also in Demokritos and all around to create new materials that have different possibilities for storage. You have the biological storage alternatives that usually that start to gain some ground. The idea is that in hardware, even the throughput of when you try to push trillions or billions or I don't know millions even measurements per second to a given target, this can be problematic. So we need new protocols for communication and so forth, new devices, new infrastructures. Okay, so I promised nuclear emergencies crisis management, and you would definitely expect this. What you will get, unfortunately, is something like that. Okay, so when we are talking about nuclear emergencies crisis management, it's not about Superman getting there and throwing the bomb to space. During a crisis, nuclear emergency crisis, what you want to do, the problems you face, besides the leak of radioactive material and so forth, is that you have people screaming with terror all around. And you have people pretending to be experts of the domain, saying, I know, 3 days from now, you will all be dead. Nice. But usually, this is not the case. So there is an information aspect of this nuclear emergency thing. So there are uncertain reports and data. There are word of mouth effect. Ah, I heard that in Demokritos they have a reactor. Next guy. I heard that in Demokritos they have an active reactor. Next guy. I heard that in Demokritos they have an active reactor that leaks a little, and so forth. And this word of mouth effect, this multiplication effect, can end up being really dangerous. So the idea is that also given the social dynamics of the web, share, tweet, and expand, this can grow. There were cases, this stands, where a given explosion or crisis was first, actually, there was a case of an earthquake in the US where people first read about it and then felt it. This means that, I don't know, in the 600 kilometers from here, someone tweeted, I am feeling an earthquake. And I got a tweet there, a pop-up, that's an earthquake. What? And exactly at that moment, I start feeling it. This happened. This thing means that information travels quickly. Okay. This poses several difficult scientific questions, and also you have all these panic, false prophets and counselors problems that can cause havoc. So the idea, there is again an European project that tries to extract information, see what has happened in the past, see reports from people, as I said, to exploit this information, because we don't know exactly what has happened usually in the first moments after the crisis, and also propose solutions to decision makers. Sorry. So, what this project is all about, it will provide an internet platform that will allow people, experts to meet in a virtual room, collect all the information they need, and from there communicate with the public and answer their hottest questions. Okay, so just to summarize, we're almost there for a break. Open data is everywhere, in several different kinds of structure. Structured information is when you have measurements of a database is structured, fully structured. You can know exactly what it contains. An Excel file might be fully structured thing. Semi-structured is something like XML. There are different ways where you are not very specific or restrictive of how people will talk. Unstructured information is your blog post. It's free text. No one poses a structure over there. So open data is everywhere in different types. Language technologies can extract and organize. Semantic technologies can enrich and exploit. So you start by organizing information, and then you use it to build new information from that and knowledge. There's very active research. Okay, and you can breathe now. Okay. I'm open to questions. Your name?
Manolis. This organization technologies by language technology, the organization of data that language technologies do, is doing in firstly and is stored somewhere and then some other application of semantic technologies come and combine them, or it's done with one application at real time in institute?
Okay. I think it's never one application instantly. So these are essentially every single effort is a completely different research effort and also application. So you have, when I ask a single query to the computer, the first thing the computer tries to do is break up my query and understand what I'm asking. Okay, because if you come to think of it, we've ended up asking the computers in the way they want us to ask them. If I speak with you, I'm going to say, what time are you going to be here tomorrow? If I ask the computer, I'm going to say, Demokritos, Istek, morning, something like that. It's a completely different line of interaction. So this, how you break up the query, is a domain, research domain. How you, who you will ask, which other machines you will ask to get information about what time we're going to meet tomorrow, for example, is a completely different process. And which of these machines, and if one of these machines is down, it's offline, I need to be able to adapt and ask elsewhere. So again, this is another domain. To be able to talk with individual machines, you need to know their language or their protocols. So this is heterogeneous query, which is another domain, and so forth. You may or may not know that whatever you listen, you hear from the news, I don't know, something, research is not built instantaneously by a single person. And it has been like that for many, many years. People built very small bricks and put them one on top of the other. Okay, you have this, we build on the shoulder, we stand on the shoulder of giants, this stands. And usually, it's not even giants. You have lots of amazing people that do very hard work to provide a very small brick. This is nice. So humanity progresses as a whole. And this stands, of course, in, on this domain as well.
Another question.
No. Okay. Okay.
Somebody else also.
They don't. Your name?
Son.
Son.
Yeah. So you just introduced these projects now. They all sound very nice, but how far have you gotten? Like, what's the current progress?
Okay. So there are three projects here, if I remember correctly. So I will show you individually. Okay, this GovInsight thing is up and running. So it's a website, you can visit it. As I said again, it's Greek, so I'm not sure it will get, but anyway, it's there. You can see at least the charts or something. The idea is that this works fine, so you can easily quantify how many comments there are per article. There are things that are almost trivial, okay? Even though they are useful, but they're trivial again. And this is another side comment. You will find yourself in several cases where what you think is trivial knowledge is very useful to people who do not own it. Okay, if you ask the politician, how would you like if I gave you this? They'd say, it's amazing! And you say, I'm just counting things. Yeah, it's not that amazing. But they cannot do it themselves. So, as I said, this is fully functional. Again, this works, so the implied topics, the topic detection part, where you try to see sets of words that form topics from the texts, again works. There is lots of noise. Several of these, so this box here says inspection, inspector, heating, and give me a second.
Air conditioning.
Thank you, guys. So, and air conditioning. This probably has to do about inspecting heating. Okay, this can be a topic, but there are different things here that do not make sense. So this says, turn back, install, Greek, about. Okay, it's machine. So this has some interesting parts, some uninteresting parts. What we are trying to do is limit the uninteresting parts here. Sentiment analysis is quite advanced in general, but it's a difficult thing to do. You will see later that, because you will do it also, sentiment analysis is about trying to determine if a person is positive or negative in a text. But if in a text I shout and then love someone, if I hate and then love someone, what is the overall sentiment? Probably crazy, but anyway, I cannot answer by a simple positive or negative. So the literature moves on to specific sentences to determine whether someone is positive or negative. This is may have an accuracy ranging from 75% to 98%. I don't know. It depends on the difficulty of the effort. Here, I don't remember. I can't give you a specific number, but usually it's much higher than randomness. It really provides an image of about whether people shouted, hated something, or loved something. Okay. So this is about going inside. The nomad and the semagro processes. So this process here is very recent. So if these things, this nomad and semagro started, I think nomad started a year ago and semagro a few months ago. So there is lots of research here, but the tools, as ready to use tools, are not ready. Okay, if that answers.
Yes, it was something like some the limitations. Many of the time limitations, the speed limitations, are centered on software or on hardware. I mean, we don't have good enough algorithms, or the data is such so a huge so number that our hardware cannot.
Okay, both. Actually, let me put it this way. If you try to run it to execute an algorithm, okay, you always also rely on hardware. So you need more and better systems. And you have, imagine that we have a server, I don't know, we have six servers. Each one of them is a 8-core somehow machine with 12 gigabytes of memory. But when you go and apply research algorithms, you're something like, I ran out of memory. It is, you have 12 gigabytes. You know, in, I don't know, back in the 80s, you had a full game running in 512 kilobytes of memory. What the hell are you doing? But the thing is that, so algorithms evolve with the hardware. Okay. Have you heard of MapReduce?
What?
MapReduce. It's a Google. Okay, it's a paradigm of writing code that tries to break up a huge work and split it up into small tasks or computers. It's similar to crowdsourcing, if you can think of it, but it's on the machine side. So MapReduce is simply running something in parallel. There are some problems that can be solved this way. Imagine you have to add 10 million numbers. Okay, due to addition properties, you can break it up into small sums and sum individually and reach up the final sum. If you try to divide 10 million numbers, you do not have the same properties as addition, and you cannot do it in such a distributed way. Google builds upon this MapReduce thing. They actually made it popular, even though it existed several years ago. So exists lots of software, Hadoop, Mahout, a Greek word just popping out. There are lots of software that allow you to distribute it, but to execute this in a distributed way some, and solve some problems, execute code. So this MapReduce paradigm allows me to add a new computer and increase the speed of execution. Google does this a lot for your search results, for example. So, as I said, algorithms move beside the hardware, and you have when 15 years ago, you needed one huge computer to do your experiments. Now you need lots of medium class computers to do the same thing.